Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I want to talk to you today about revival. The reason why God sent me back to the States for these seasons that I'm here. The love of many has waxed cold, as the Lord said it would in the last days. I want to read a few Bible verses to you, brothers and sisters. From our living God. After Brother Peter and Brother John, in Acts chapter 3, came to the gate called Beautiful, there was a man that had been crippled. He was crippled there when Jesus was on earth, but God saved his healing to such a time as this. And that's a lesson in itself and a word in itself for people who are seeking physical healing. Not only is there faith and all these things, but there's also God's timing, like the blind man that Jesus made the mud for, and this guy at the gate called Beautiful. Obviously, Jesus had passed out by there many times in his ministry, but the Lord chose not to heal the man at that time. But this time, the man who was over 40 years old had been there begging for years and years and years. He asked Peter and John for some money, and they said, "Silver and gold we have none, but what I have I give to you freely. In the name of Jesus Christ, arise and walk." The man was healed. So Peter and John, they took the opportunity to preach and gave them the gospel about Jesus Christ. I want to read to you what they said starting in Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Peter said, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out." You know, repentance is part of believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, and repenting is part of salvation, brothers and sisters. We need to repent of our sins, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing, revival, shall come from the presence of the Lord. Because I want to talk about revival. Verse 30, "And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven," he's talking about the second coming of Christ, "whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution," or reconciliation of all things, "which God has spoken by the mouth of his holy prophets since the world began." Listen, brothers and sisters. I also want to look at Acts chapter 4. What I'm trying to tell you is this. Since yesterday while I was praying, the Lord kept giving me the word reconciliation. And the Lord, you know, tonight when I was praying this afternoon, the Lord reminded me of the vision that I had that I talked on the radio show about. I was on that radio show, Tribulation Now, and they invited me to be on there to talk about the vision that I had. We didn't get into it too much. We were just talking and fellowshipping and about how awesome is the Lord and talking about the Lord, and just got caught up in, you know, in praising him and giving glory to his name. But in the vision that I had, where the Lord turned to me and touched me with the scroll, which is the title deed to the earth from Revelation chapter 6, with the seals on it. He touched me with that, and I was revived. That's where we are right now, brother, sister, revival. He turned at the second watch, touched the bride with it, and then the bride was consumed by the liquid life, liquid love, liquid gold that came out of the scroll, and she was raptured. She was removed. She became the liquid gold and was no more. You know, just like Enoch, he walked with God and then he was no more. So if we're revived, this is a whole nother level, and the Lord has given me all these levels that I can just barely got at the tip of my brain, but as the Lord is leading me right now. When we're revived, we become part of the bride, and that's when we're consumed and melted away. Our flesh is melted away, and we become that living gold, as the word of the Lord kept telling me. Not liquid, but it is liquid. It was like a river of gold, but it's living gold. Talk about the living water, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is living water, but we, as the body of Christ, are liquid gold, living gold. The living gold, the living water, Holy Spirit, living gold, us, the bride, the body of Christ. We're talking about the body of Christ. You know, the part of Jesus, the bride, when two get married, they become one flesh. You know, that's why we talk about the bride of Christ. Not all, as I mentioned before, all this nonsense, people debating words and parsing words on YouTube. We are the bride. Jesus is the head of the church, as it tells us in Ephesians. They always read this at weddings, how Jesus is the head of the church as the husband is supposed to be the head of the marriage. That's why the two become one flesh. That's why we're known as the body of Christ. We're his bride. We're part of him. We are literally part of Christ. Do you understand? He's the head. We are the body. So, brothers and sisters, we become one with Christ. In the spirit, when you get saved, where the Bible says, people talk about, let me give you the theology of what the Bible says. When you're saved, the Bible says the Holy Spirit baptizes us into the body of Christ. When you're saved, the Holy Spirit baptizes you into the body of Christ, the Bible says. Now when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, Jesus baptizes with the Holy Ghost, and then it talks about him baptism of fire when he said the judgment. That's the judgment. His winnowing fork is in his hand. That's talking about separating the wheat from the chaff at judgment with fire. But right now the Lord Jesus baptizes his people into the Holy Spirit. Talking about with evidence of speaking in tongues and prophesying and all that, like we see in Acts chapter 2, starting at verse 38. They were baptized in the Holy Spirit, and everybody thought they were drunk because they were speaking in tongues and prophesying at 9 o'clock in the morning, speaking in all these different languages. So the Holy Spirit baptizes you into the body of Christ, and then the Lord Jesus Christ baptizes you with the Holy Ghost. Understand? That's the theology of all these things, directly from the Word of God. Anyway, so that second part of my vision where the Lord turned from the 6 o'clock, as the Lord has told me since then, you know, the evening, it's nighttime, night is coming. The Lord revived me. Those who are revived, those five wise virgins, we are the bride. We become no more, like Enoch walked with God and he was no more. We become no more. We turn into that liquid life, the liquid living gold. Living liquid gold of the body of Christ. We're gone. We're no more. We become part of Christ. And then the Lord, in the third watch, he turned to the earth and he began to open up those seals. In the fourth watch, he turned back to the throne and reconciled all things to God. Now, lots of people love to try to focus on about the midnight hour, which I mentioned that when the bride disappeared, the second watch ends at the midnight hour, 9 to 12 p.m., 12 a.m., midnight. The midnight hour is one of the levels of interpretation of that vision. People love to keep trying to calculate the day of the rapture. The Lord doesn't want us to know. He says, no man knows the day or the hour. He wants us to be always. He wanted every generation to be prepared. Every generation to be looking up. That's why he left it like he did, because he wants us to always be ready, always prepared. As he said in Luke 21:36, to watch and pray always that you be kind of worthy to escape the tribulation and stand before him, the Son of Man. The Lord wanted every generation to be alert to his sudden return as a thief in the night. And so that's why we don't know. But we know the signs and seasons are here. There's no doubt about that, brothers and sisters. But the Lord doesn't want us sitting around obsessing, trying to calculate the date. He wants us to be and do the work of Christ. We're supposed to have the mind of Christ. We're supposed to, you know, live in the will of Christ. As I mentioned in the short video that I just made that I already posted, that I will post when I finish this one first. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that time of reconciliation, the text I just read you, was that fourth watch. And that's what the Lord wants me to talk to you about. That time of reconciliation. In that same text that I just read you from Acts chapter 3, starting at verse 19, the times of refreshing, revival, times of reconciliation, restoration, reconciliation, of course, is the Bible says that God would reconcile all things in Christ, and then Christ would present himself to God. See, Jesus presents himself to the Father. In him, we live and breathe and have our being. In Christ, can you understand this? He who has an ear, let him hear what the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, is quickening to the church. I'm quoting all Bible verses here. The Lord would present himself to the Father. We are in Christ. In Christ, we live and breathe and have our being. We move and breathe and have our being. We are the body of Christ. We are part of Jesus. The two become one flesh, just like a husband and wife getting married, as I've said many times. God didn't make his relationship between the Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Messiah, and the church after the pattern of Adam and Eve. He foreknew from the foundation. The Bible says Jesus with Christ was slain from the foundation of the world. So God made Adam and Eve in a pattern after what he would do between Christ and his church. You understand this? The egg didn't come before the chicken. You know, Christ was there in the beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. John chapter 1, the Gospel of John. And then in 1 John chapter 1, the Apostle John begins with the same concept about the Word being in the beginning, that which was in the beginning. It's the same as it is, you know, about Jesus being in the beginning, brothers and sisters. He was the Word and he was God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Down in verse 13, and then the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Hallelujah. Praise God. One of the greatest. If you ever try to memorize the Bible, memorize the Gospel of John, particularly chapter 1, chapter 3. Awesome stuff, brothers and sisters. Praise God for the poetic beauty of the words of the Holy Spirit spoken through the apostles, particularly Apostle John in this text. Anyway, brothers and sisters, fall in love with the Word of God. There's so many awesome things that were spoken by the apostles. John, Peter, any of them, awesome words that were spoken. Praise God for the unction of the Holy Spirit, God. You know, you should pray, God, use me like you used those guys. You know, let me be used by you as those guys were used when they preach. You can read the sermons of the apostles in the book of Acts as they preached in public to Gentiles, like at Mars Hill, that's called in the King James, the Areopolis, there in, and is it Athens where Peter, Paul preached there to the Gentiles about the resurrection of the Lord. Let's look at Acts chapter 4. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to tell you our last mission. Has the Lord given me that book? And I wrote all, you know, 90% of the book, we focused on about Satan's plan for the ages. Final boarding call before the rapture. Satan's plan for the ages, all the things culminating in the kingdom of Antichrist. That's the greatest, you know, the redoing of the Tower of Babel. The Antichrist, that's the capstone for Satan's master work that he's done throughout history of man, to have man to worship him and not God. That's his master plan, to try to be God, be like God, to I will ascend unto the throne, I will be like the Most High God, all those things. But the rest of the end of the title of the book the Lord gave me when we were almost finished with it was... and our last mission, that's what I'm talking about. So our last mission is just like I had a dream when I first started in the ministry. This is what's going on today, brothers and sisters. I've talked about this a little bit before. This is here the wisdom of the Most High God. I had a dream that I was in this, I'll make it short and sweet here. I was in a chairlift going up to a hotel, like a ski lift thing, but it was actually like a, you know, not where you sit down, but you stand up inside. It was a gondola, whatever, ski lift thing, kind of cable car going up to the top of this hotel. And I've told this a few times, part of it, but when I was going up in that thing with my family, I noticed that the gondola driver was a demon. Nobody else could see it but me. He was a demon. He had black fingernails and black earlobes and he was kind of, and he could see in his skin it was like green and decrepit, and he was dead. He was like an undead, whatever. A zombie or whatever. He's a demon. We got up there to this lobby of the hotel, and there were thousands of Christians, brothers and sisters. Thousands of Christians lined up in different lines, and there was like a window. They were standing at the position of attention like an army. Before these are, actually it's called parade rest. You can look that up. They were standing at parade rest in front of all these different windows. And the windows had all these rules. You know, religion rules. You got to do this, you got to do that. The people were lined up, standing perfectly still. And then the next would go to the window, the next would go to the window. But there was a lot of different windows. There were lines in every direction. Thousands of people. Nobody was getting anything done. And it was supposed to be the church, right? And there were demons who were telling people, stay in line, don't say anything, move, you're next, and all this, like drill sergeants, you know. They were demons. And when I first got there, I got in one of the lines, and I was like, wait a minute, you know what, in the world, we don't have to do all that. And then I looked on the wall, brothers and sisters, written in giant letters. It said Acts chapter 4 and 5 was written in giant letters on the wall. And then I got out of line, and I began to yell at the people. What are you doing? You don't need to stand in this line. Get out of this lines. This is all from the devil. This is all man-made stuff and demonic doctrines of men. Get out of line. Get out of line. You're free. You're free. You're free. And I began to shout to him that you're free. You know, call upon the name of the Lord. Give him the gospel and all this stuff. You know, we're free in Christ. And then that was the end of my dream. Well, actually, there was another part when I had a second part of that dream. I can't remember in my notes if it was the same night. It might have been. act two of that dream, I was in the same hotel, and after I did that, I went to the top. I was on the penthouse level of the hotel. You know, it means you're being, you know, high in Christ, you know, high, you know, close up in the spiritual things. And I was in a penthouse suite, and I went out on a balcony, brothers and sisters. And I was all by myself. My, you know, even my wife, she didn't make it. She fell asleep on the bed, and I was all by myself. And I got out on the balcony, and I could see, like across the ocean, I could see this beautiful, shining city. And the more I kept looking, I kept telling my wife, hey, come look, hey, look, look at this. It's coming. The city is coming toward us. But, you know, no one, you know, I was all by myself shouting and shouting that the city was coming. And then, you know, it got closer and closer and brighter and clearer, this city. So that city, of course, is the kingdom of heaven. You know, that was way back that the Lord gave me that dream years ago, that the kingdom of heaven was coming, and I would be there watching it and seeing it by myself and calling out, you know. And so that's what I've been doing, brothers and sisters. But anyway, what is Acts chapter 4 and 5 about, brothers and sisters? It's about the Sanhedrin, or religious leaders, telling the apostles, do not preach about the name of Jesus. Do not use the name of Jesus. You know, we're going to beat you. They did beat them in that. So what do the apostles do in reaction to the persecution? This is what I want to talk to you about revival. You know, there's times for revival, like when you hear the standard traditional proper message of revival, it talks about repentance. And that's true. I've done lots of preaching that revival comes. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, from King Solomon's prayer at the dedication of the temple, King Solomon's temple. It says that if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, turn from their wicked ways and seek my face, I would hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. Now that's what we need to do as a nation. We need to humble ourselves and pray and turn from our wicked ways. We need to repent. Repent means to turn from, you know, to turn from what you're doing. So when people talk about repentance, it's not just saying you're sorry, but you also, you know, try to stop doing it. You know, you make every effort that you can to stop doing it. And, you know, sometimes, as we know, as someone is repenting, they sometimes, if they're an alcoholic, they got to go to AA or whatever. No matter what you say about AA, we know that's not Christianity. But if someone needs to go through a 12-step program to get loose from alcohol, some people are spiritually let loose in 5 minutes. Some people, it takes them 6 months. But God knows the thoughts and intents of their heart. So in repentance is they say, hey, they decide they want to stop drinking right now. They ask God to help them. They repent of it. They say they're sorry. And then they make every effort to stop. They're in the act of repentance. They stop going to the bar, you know, and then maybe they drink a little bit, then they, you know, they taper off drinking if they're addicted, as an example. It takes them 6 months or one day. I don't want to get off onto a sidetrack too much there, brothers and sisters, like I do a lot of times. I want to stay on this message. So you can be proud of me. I'll try to stay on message. Let's see. Acts chapter 4. They were persecuted for using the name Jesus, like at the gate called Beautiful thing that we just read about. And then all the apostles were arrested, and they were even beaten. And what does it say? They said they prayed. It says verse 18, Acts chapter 4, verse 18. They called them and commanded them not to speak at all nor teach in the name of Jesus. And then, of course, Peter and John answered and said unto them, this is like in my dream, unto them, whether it is right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than to God, judge ye. For we cannot help but speak those things which we have seen and heard. So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding nothing how they might punish them. This is the two of them were arrested after the healing the man at the gate called Beautiful, Acts chapter 3. Then in Acts chapter 5, all the apostles were arrested and beaten. So at the end of 4, after they were released, they let them go. And then it says, you know, it was a notable miracle they did, so that's why they didn't really beat them. And then it says, and when they and being let go, they went to their own company, to the other apostles and the, you know, the 120 and all that. Actually, they had already added the thousands of people by that time. They reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them. In Acts 4, 24. And when they had heard that, they lifted up their voices to God with one accord and said, Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of thy servant David has said, why do the heathen rage, and the people imagine vain things? and the kings of the earth stood up, and the rulers gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. You know, that's what we're facing today, brothers and sisters. The same kind of a thing going into the tribulation period. We're not in the tribulation yet, but things are already there 90% here in America and in Europe. Persecution of Christians. If you say something bad about Bruce Jenner, the transsexual who claims to be a Christian, if you say anything about gay marriage and all this, you know, we're getting to the point of persecution, even here in the United States. Verse 27, for of a truth against thy holy child Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, hath gathered together, for to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done. So they're saying to God that, of course, you know, it was your will that Jesus be crucified. And then verse 29, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word. See, that's what they're asking for. Not that, let's get, you know, let me be raptured today, even though, of course, we want to be raptured. They said, can we speak your word with boldness? Fill us with boldness. That's revival. Let's see what they said. By stretching forth thy hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. So the apostles were asking for boldness to preach, and that more signs and wonders would be done by the name of Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake of the word of God with boldness. So the Lord literally shook the place like with an earthquake, and then they had a new Pentecost. They had a second Pentecostal type of experience, a revival, a times of refreshing, as the first text I read from Acts chapter 3. A times of refreshing had come from the throne of God. This is one of them. And this just is just within, say, a year or two. I think this, you know, when I went to school, I'm trying to remember. I think it's about 18 months. This happened within the first 18 months of the church. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. And listen to this. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said of them, any of them, that aught of the things which he possessed was his own. Anything that he possessed was his own, but they all had things in common. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was any of them that lacked, talking about physical, earthly possessions. For as many as possessors of land or houses sold them and bought the price of the things they had sold and laid them down at the apostles' feet and distributed, distribution was made to every man according to he had need. So I want to say this. Let me just say this about that topic. A part of revival is all these things, all the things that I just read to you. Boldness, more signs and wonders. God would shake the place, the manifestation of his power, of his Holy Spirit, and people having this, you know, reconciliation. I mentioned before about reconciliation with God, the Lord reconciling all things unto himself and then presenting it to God, the Father. But it's also reconciliation between, you know, be ye reconciled one to another, the Bible says, that we Christians would be reconciled. This is a part of revival, that we'd have forgiveness of everything, you know, that would all be united in Christ, not ecumenicalism, what the Pope is trying to do. I'm talking about truly born-again Christians being reconciled, personal, you know, grievances and dislikes and arguments with each other over non-essential doctrines and all these kind of things. Be reconciled one together, to be in one mind and one accord. And also, what is he talking about here? Earthly provisions that people give one to another as each have a need. We be, you know, united, brothers and sisters. You know, as you know, I always say, because I talk to my parents, and they're not really Christians. They're liberals, and they're big promoters of Obama and all that, and they think that the welfare state is great. But I always tell them, it's true. If the church was doing its job, we wouldn't need welfare. Because the church should be doing that, especially for their own, for the church, for other Christians. We have no need for abortion. If churches were, you know, doing more to help and counsel young women, not just tell them, oh, abortion's, you know, getting pregnant when you're not married is a sin. There's one church here in my hometown, in Winston-Salem. It's a Christian, Pinedale Christian Church. They have a young woman's home, a young unwed mother's home, that young pregnant women can stay there, and they counsel them, and they, you know, help them with adoption services. And it's, you know, not we know fornication is a sin, but the girl's already pregnant. There's already a new life there. Okay, we can deal with her repentance and get married and and stop fornicating or get married or whatever, that's a one issue. But shunning them and throwing them under the bus and saying abortion is a murder, but yet you don't, that we don't reach out with an alternative as the body of Christ, is, you know, these are the kind of things, this one example, one issue, or where the church has failed. As I talked before, where is the church? Where is the church? And I don't like to go negative, because it's what we can do, not what we did yesterday, but what we as this generation, what can we do? The generation before us has dropped the ball. In the 1950s, that's what I was writing about in the book, the church dropped the ball. We let our Christian country be destroyed because of liberal tree-hugger Christians has allowed the devil's children to come in and take charge and destroy our churches, destroy our country, destroy our society. Where has the church been? I just want to say this, brothers and sisters, I know we want the rapture to happen, okay? God's not going to delay, you know, stop or change the rapture about what we're doing in that sense. While we're here, we have to give an account for the things we've done. What has this generation done? We can reclaim this country. You know, as the Bible says back there in Isaiah, I keep wanting to say Isaiah 58, it's Isaiah 55, I think it is, 56, along in there. It says, you know, God's ear is not deaf that he can't hear, and his arm not too short that he can't reach down. The Lord can reach down anywhere, at any place, at any time, in any season, any situation. God can hear the cry of his people. God answers the cry of his people. If my people, who are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked way, your wicked ways, your cold heart, you've waxed cold. Most people, most Christians have waxed cold. You know, judgmental, hypocritical, self-righteous, self-indulgent, self-promoting. We are supposed to turn from our wicked ways and humble ourselves. It's not just telling sinners, yeah, people need to get saved. I'm not talking about that right now. This message is not about evangelism. See, that's the problem with these old, you know, I came from a Baptist background before I received the power of the Holy Ghost, you know, with that form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And it's always every week. It's John 3:16. Every week. Oh, everybody out there is going to hell. Oh, you know, they got Bruce Jenner and the gays are doing this, that, and that. Praise God. It's, you know, all of us in here are going to heaven. I know I'm saved. We're going to heaven. Everybody else is going to hell but us. You know, God didn't call us to preach to the choir. You know, he said to become all things. Paul said, I become all things to all people that I might win some. You know, God endures the foolishness of preaching that some might be saved. You know, and so, brothers and sisters, we, the church, preaching besides evangelism is to the church to make disciples. So that's why my videos are not the number one most popular videos on YouTube. I'm not on here just repeating every week and every video about salvation. The hard part, the hard work is discipleship. To be conformed to the image of Christ. To walk in the boldness that the prayer of the apostles here were, and the church. It's not just the apostles, but the whole church in Acts chapter 4 in Jerusalem. They prayed for boldness. To do what? To proclaim the word of God, and that signs and wonders would follow the name, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And God shook the place because they asked the Lord, our Father, to fill them with his power. So I ask you today, a lot of people, I'll say this too. I want to, you know, hey, I don't, you know, I try to be as real as I can. There are lots of people who ask to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And of course, I'm just telling you what people tell me. God is the judge of all these things. I'm trying to put up a mirror. The Bible says in James that the Bible is a mirror. You know, that a man beholding himself in a mirror and just walks away is not a doer of the word. But you behold your face in a mirror steadfast, and then you change what you see wrong in the mirror. That's why James calls the Bible, the word of God, a mirror. You're supposed to behold yourself in there and then be a doer of the word. So what I'm trying to say is there's tons of people that want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. They want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. They want revival. Not to speak boldly the word of God. Not to be used by God in signs and wonders. But that they can have some personal growth experience and have some kind of a personal thing out of it. And then you got your churches seeking revival for what purpose? that they might grow their own kingdom. That's why God's not sending revival to these churches. I should have, you know, someone wrote a book before, Why Revival Tarries. I think Leonard Ravenhill preached about that. But, you know, that's what I'm talking about. At this moment, the church's motivation is to grow their own kingdom, whether it be their denominational pride or just their local mega church pride. All these motives that are not of God. Not to win the lost, not to make disciples of the nations, not to speak boldly the word of God, not to see the signs and wonders for people, for the kingdom of Christ, not for your own kingdom of your own denomination, your own church, your own ministry, or for your own personal experience. As an example, brothers and sisters, I've had several people contact me that wanted to come to the Philippines. Not to serve the Lord, but for their own personal growth and what did they say? I even had one guy that said, you know, I like to drink about 5 beers a day, but I'm a Christian and I want to go there and I need to swim in the ocean every day for an hour. That's his hobby. And then I just need to see, you know, what does God want me to do? That's a whole nother topic. I won't go any more negative on that. Our motive should be always what Jesus said. The chief end of man is to bring glory to God. God's purpose for us is to be conformed to the image of Christ. Why? That we might bring glory to His name. God wants people saved to bring glory to His name. God wants none to perish, but all to come to repentance, because He loves us. And He gave Himself for us. And He wants to bring glory to His name, that His name would be exalted in the presence of His enemies. That God would prepare a table for us, His church, and His people in the presence of His enemies, Satan and the demons and all the wicked people who will never be saved, who God foreknew would always say no to Him. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm going to end this and I'll come back. I've got a whole bunch of more teachings I want to do on this, on revival. What's real revival? What God sent me back to America for, to be a part of, what He wants to do. I'll be back. I know there's a remnant of people that want to see God's will be done, for no motive other than to bring glory to God and to be obedient to God. Not for anybody's namesake or any denominational namesake or gain of any kind, but that God would get all the glory. That's what it's all about.